Good morning. First to breaking news out of Queensland, where a light plane has gone down off the Sunshine Coast. It's understood the Cessna aircraft was travelling to American Samoa before making a call for help and crashing just after 9 o'clock local time. Two people have been retrieved from the water and they are right now on their way to hospital. We will have more on this for you as it comes to hand. The sporting world has gathered at the MCG this morning for the state memorial service for AFL icon Ron Barassi. He was one of the AFL's most revered figures, a towering personality and a champion player who became one of the game's greatest coaches. Joshua Dorr is at the MCG for us. Josh, the who's who of football are there with you, all paying tribute to Barassi.
They certainly are, Lizzie. Good morning to you. It's a real diverse and star-studded cast of football legends from right across Victoria and the country who have arrived here at the beautiful MCG behind me. Fittingly, a venue where Ronald Dale Barassi really made his name throughout an illustrious career before his sad passing in September, aged 87. And there's more than 5,000 people who have made their way through here in the last hour, the service getting underway a short time ago. And as I said, there's so many football greats, but simply just punters and fans who have been touched by Barass over his journey, be it as a player or as a coach, or even who have shared stories from perhaps their parents or grandparents. He's a figure who has had such a big impact on the AFL here in this big city. And as I said, the service is underway. 10 Premiership Cups that Ron Barassi won across his time as a player and coach, from Melbourne to Carlton, North Melbourne and Sydney, they're all out on the MCG, on the hallowed turf today as part of this service. And we're currently hearing from his son, Ron Jr., among a number of friends and family who will pay tribute today at this state memorial. But coming into the ground, so many legends in their own rights who were touched by Barassi and shared some of their memories as they made their way here today.
When you think that I came out of a desert and into the live in Bunbury, then end up playing on the big stage. So it's a great journey for me, so I appreciate Ron for that.
The one guy that was indestructible that would never, ever, you know, would forever be with us, Barassi. Probably in some sense, you know, I arrived here today, you know, knowing, you know, I know it's a memorial and I know that there is a finale to it all, but, you know, in some, it felt a bit eerie because I don't think it is. He's still going to be around.
I was with him in 1966 and we won the flag in 68. That was fantastic. We hadn't won a flag for 21 years, and that was fantastic. All because of him, because of his persona and the way he trained us.
Such a marvellous day here at the MCG, and fittingly in Melbourne today, a top of 31 degrees. 31, of course, the famous number that Ron Barassi wore so proudly throughout his career. And we'll bring you coverage of the state service throughout the day in Nine News. Lizzie.
A life well lived. Joshua Dorr there for us at the MCG. Well, there's more fallout from the Optus outage today. As customers react to the news, there will be no cash compensation. Instead, the telco giant offering its 10 million customers 200 gigabytes of free data. For the latest on this, we are joined by Damien Ryan. Damo, not the response customers wanted from Optus at all.
No, certainly. I think when Optus came up with this idea, they thought it might be the magic get-out-of-jail card, but it's certainly has not gone that way. They've come under increasing criticism. In fact, this company is lurching from one crisis to the next. There's no doubt about that. The offer of 2 gigabytes, well, customers, many customers out there already have unlimited data.
Yeah.
And there are others that you speak to and they say, look, I pay for data and I never exceed the data that I pay for each month. So they're saying, what is this all about? It has been such a PR disaster, a clown show, it's been described by many. Let's see what we had with people we spoke to today on the streets.
They should slash bills or at least they reimburse customers for, you know, what they lost for that outage, because it was for 12 hours.
My customers want to keep paying for a card, but it's a company's decline. Some people don't want to wait as they saw about the, oh, it's declines coming, so they just come back. So we can't say any hello anyway.
People lost a lot of money for all their businesses and things like that, so I think they should do more.
Well, I think it's a case study in how not to handle a crisis for any industry, but one that is so important and so central to the lives of Australians. The response has been totally inadequate.
Yeah, strong words there from Wayne Swan. Now, what next, Damo? Can the telecommunications industry watchdog actually force the company to pay compensation?
Well, they can, but the company, of course, Optus, is saying, look, we're not handing over any money, but they may be forced, they may be liable to do so under the Telecommunications Act. It could see half a million businesses, we're told, so far, that have put their hand up to say, we've been impacted by what happened the other day. So they really, as the ombudsman, has the power to fine or seek compensation of up to $100,000 for each company and $1,500 for individuals. So certainly that figure will stack up.
Yeah, that's going to get very expensive. Now, let's talk about the CEO, Kelly Bayer Rosmarin. What's next for her?
I don't know. I really don't know. We saw her leave work this morning. You know, how long will she have this job? Many people, from senior politicians to people on the street, are saying how long can she last in the role as CEO after dealing with the fallout from the cyber hacking last year. It will be interesting. And so she's under intense scrutiny, but that's going to grow because the federal government wants a review of the whole, you know, debacle, which it was the other day. And of course, then the Senate want to go after her. She and her management will have to face an almighty grilling in Canberra for an a Senate inquiry. So, look, it's going to be a tough road, and but she's toughing it out for the moment.
Yeah, we still don't know the answer to many questions. Thank you, Damo.
Okay.
A 26-year-old man has faced court after being charged over an alleged shooting spree on the New South Wales mid-north coast. Sophie Upcroft reports from Kempsey Court.
One of the men arrested on the riverbank at Kempsey after an alleged 14-hour crime spree has just appeared here in Kempsey local court. 26-year-old Corey Glass is facing six charges, accused of firing multiple shots at cars, including a police vehicle, from a black Mercedes ute as he and another man, who police say is 32-year-old Tyrone Russell, travelled up and down the M1 in the early hours of yesterday morning. The body of a man was found on the side of the road, on the same road in Port Macquarie, where police say their car was shot at. Officers say they can't confirm if or how that man is linked to the two men now in custody after they were cornered in the scrub behind the Kempsey Big W yesterday afternoon.
There was police everywhere with guns and German Shepherd, their dog, and then they all of a sudden started going towards the tree down there, and they got him, they brought him out, and it was just mad.
Tyrone Russell was taken to hospital briefly last night, but is now back at the police station. We understand homicide detectives are on their way here to interview him. He is yet to be charged.
A small breakthrough in the Israel-Hamas conflict. With the news, there will now be a four-hour daily pause on military operations in northern Gaza to allow humanitarian aid to get in and desperate Palestinians to get out. US President Joe Biden had been pressing the Israeli Prime Minister for much more, which hasn't happened so far.
Did you ask him to pause for 3 days to get the hostages out for that
length of time? Yes, I've asked for even a longer pause for some of them.
As many as 50,000 Palestinians have fled northern Gaza yesterday alone. The federal government has confirmed it will start to release dozens of people from immigration detention after a landmark High Court ruling this week. Let's go live to our federal politics reporter Fiona Willen in Canberra. Fee, how will this work?
Well, Lizzie, around 92 people could walk free very soon. So this is after the High Court ruled this week that indefinite detention is unlawful if there's little prospect of that person being deported. So this is the result of a legal challenge mounted by a stateless man from Myanmar. He was being kept in immigration detention indefinitely after spending time in jail for child sex offences. Now, Australia can't send him home as he's from a persecuted minority and no country would resettle him due to his conviction. But the High Court found his indefinite detention was illegal, so he's been released this week. And that's now paved the way for others in similar situations to be freed too. The government has vowed to work with authorities to ensure that community safety is upheld.
The release of this individual and further individuals in the coming period, that release will happen under the strictest possible conditions. We will, from there, assess the government's position and what steps we can take going forward.
Unfortunately, Australians can have no confidence that the Albanese government is doing what is necessary to protect them. Let's remember that these people have either committed serious crimes or otherwise violated the character provisions of the Migration Act. They are not Australian citizens, they do not have valid visas to be here, and they are now going to be released into the community.
Now, while the acting Prime Minister has been facing questions over this in Adelaide, the Prime Minister is holding talks in the Cook Islands. Anthony Albanese has spent the morning on a boat with Pacific leaders, and it may look like a pretty laid-back setting, but they do have some serious issues to discuss. Pacific nations are particularly concerned about climate change and how it's affecting them. The Australian government has pledged $350 million to climate-related infrastructure projects in the Pacific, and Anthony Albanese has indicated that he'll make further announcements later today. Lizzie?
Fiona Willem there in Canberra.